Pop- och rockikonen Amy Winehouse dog alltså 27 år gammal för nästan precis ett år sedan. Hon var dyrkad för sin magiska röst, men hennes privatliv handlade mest om hennes tunga drogmissbruk som enligt hennes pappa berodde på Blake Fielder Civil, hennes stora kärlek under flera år. Samma Blake som var upphovet till succéalbumet Back to Black. Jag träffade Mitch Winehouse i London för en exklusiv intervju. En pappa som har kämpat hårt för att rädda sin dotter ur missbruket.
I have this dream to be very famous, to work on stage. It's a lifelong ambition. I want people to hear my voice and just forget their troubles for 5 minutes. I want to be remembered for being an actress, a singer, to sell out concerts and sell out West End and Broadway shows. Amy Winehouse, age 12.
12 years old.
Yeah.
And she did become a huge icon for millions of fans. And for those people, she was this remarkable artist, but lived a very self-destructive life, a short life.
I don't think she was. It was a self-destructive life.
What do you think?
I think that she wasn't self-destructive. She, like all strong people have a weakness, and her weakness was Blake. That was her weakness. Superman, the strongest man in the world. You know Superman, the comic?
Absolutely.
Right, the little piece of green rock, it's called kryptonite, and it would kill Superman. And that's what happened with Amy. You know, a very, very strong girl, very strong-willed, and Blake was her kryptonite.
She met the wrong guy, you mean?
She wouldn't see it that way, but clearly it wasn't a relationship that was going to be a long-lasting, loving relationship with all the families coming around for dinner and things like that. That was never going to happen. So if Blake had been a skydiver or a tennis player, maybe she would have become a great tennis player, but you know, that wasn't to be.
Is he responsible for her death?
No, 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 not at all. Not at all. They're his words, not mine. He said that he introduced Amy to Class A drugs. She took to it like a duck to water. He wouldn't want her to die. He didn't kill her. That was just an unfortunate accident.
As a protective and proud father, at what moment did you start seriously to worry about Amy taking drugs?
When Blake and Amy first got together, I didn't understand the extent of his drug addiction. It was only later, after they were married, that I was told that he was a drug user. And then I began to worry about Amy. And it was only in August 2007 that I saw with my own eyes. I didn't see her take drugs. I never saw her take drugs or even drink. She'd never drink in front of me. And at that point, I knew there was a serious problem.
Decide to write a book about her.
As soon as Amy died, there was press speculation that she committed suicide, that she was depressed, she took a drugs overdose. All of these things were true. All of these things were
not true.
And I also felt by writing the book, it would help me with my recovery. To a certain extent, it has done.
Like a therapy, like helping
cathartic.
You with the grief?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So writing the book, I felt very helpful. When I had to read the book back, when we checked the book, that was devastating. And the third reason was, when Amy passed away, we created the Amy Winehouse Foundation, and we needed money for the foundation. So the best way that we were going to be able to get money is for me to write a book and all of my proceeds goes into the foundation. The mission statement is to help disadvantaged young children and young people up to about 21 or 22.
Can you describe the relation you had with your daughter?
Well, she was my daughter and I'm her dad. And we had a fantastic relationship. But I don't know whether it was any different to the relationship you have with your dad. We're very close, but Amy was close with her mum, with my wife, with her brother. She was a great family girl. She loved her uncles and aunts and her cousins, and she was always with them, even when she was a big star. None of that made any difference to her. Her family were the most important thing for her.
Did she change in her personality getting famous?
No, and, you know, we're in Soho here, and you know, people talk a lot about Amy and Camden Town, but in Soho, we would walk down this street here, Wardour Street, and we'd start at the top, and as we walked down the street, on the right is a Caribbean restaurant, and she'd go into the kitchen downstairs, and the chef is called Auntie, so she'd go in and say, "Hi, Auntie, how are you? How's your brother? How's your sister? How's your son? Has he gone to prison yet?" As that she knew everything about everybody. And I'd say to her, "How do you do that?" She said, "Oh, Dad." She thought everyone was like her. So it wasn't special to her. And it was just wonderful seeing this girl who was, this was after Back to Black. So she was more famous than Adele and Lady Gaga rolled into one, walking down her street in London, and people were just...
No lifeguards.
Me.
You were the lifeguard.
Just Amy and I. Mm-hmm. And that's how we liked it. It was beautiful. Just to see my daughter doing that was great. You know, sometimes I got a bit too big for my boots. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought I was a star, you know, being the dad. And she'd say to me, "Dad..."
She took you down.
Yeah, she'd go, "Dad, what are you doing? Dad..."
Mm-hmm. But could you see your daughter change by taking drugs, like the personality of a person that is a drug addict?
Well, look, you know, she suffered with drug addiction. In 2007, she could have died easily. I mean, by luck, in the book, I saved her once, just by luck. Had she had died in 2007, I'd have said, fair enough, because she was very ill.
But how did this change your life?
Oh,
like
our
always
life
being
was
worried.
Our life. My life was changed completely. I'd sit in a chair all night with the phone. I couldn't sleep properly. I was on call. I'd have to leave at 3 o'clock in the morning. I'd go and I'd have a fight with a drug dealer. Just me, no one else. I didn't want anyone else involved. If anyone was gonna get hurt, I didn't want anyone else involved. And Somehow I managed to get all those people away from her.
That must have been so difficult, since she was growing to be a big star and everyone wanted a piece of her. How was it to...
It's difficult.
...struggle with that?
You know, if I think about it now, I can't even remember what it was like. Because, you know, there were some awful confrontations with some very dangerous people. But they knew, you know, your dad would be the same with you. If your life was being threatened, it wouldn't matter. Your dad would break that wall down, wouldn't he, to save you. And that's what I was doing for my daughter. So these people, whoever they were, they knew they'd have to kill me as well.
Amy Winehouse liv beskrevs ofta med svarta rubriker, men paparazzis och skandalartiklar tycktes inte bekomma henne.
Amy had a very good philosophy. She just said, "Don't read the papers, because tomorrow they won't be there." You know what fish and chips? Mm-hmm. Okay, in the old days, we used to put fish and chips in newspapers, and we used to eat in the right. You know, and
so yesterday's news you had in the fish and chips.
Yesterday's news, today's fish and chip paper. Okay. She said, "Don't worry about it, Dad."
Was Amy ever comfortable being a superstar?
Well, at certain times she wasn't, at certain times she wasn't, like most people. You know, but Amy was just a normal girl. She was supremely talented, a wonderful songwriter, brilliant, a brilliant singer.
Även djupt nere i missbruket var Amy noggrann med sin image. Många varumärken ville ha henne som reklampelare.
I went to see Amy. I said, Amy, they want to know about the perfume deal. And she said, and bearing in mind she was taking drugs, she said, I'm a musician, Dad. That's going to harm my credibility. Which means, you know, she felt that drugs wasn't going to harm her credibility. Perfume would, you know, which kind of shows you what drugs do to your mind. I